here on the Virtual Entertainment Programming Network. TVEPN.com.
Welcome everyone to the top rated Ustream show in the Bay Area, the Slam Show. I am the Commander in Chief running this ship, the Slamster. Before I begin, I always introduce my co-hosting staff on the stool. Let's give a big round of applause for the lovely Lady Sage. What up, girl?
Welcome everybody. It's a full house.
Big time. Special, special edition,
yes,
Sage.
Yes.
I'm just amazed right now. We got a lot of firepower musically. I don't think our studio could hold this.
Nope.
We're going to have to expand it. Keep open the roof. In the sound booth, I have my super partner in crime. Let's give a big round of applause for DJ Stallion.
Yo, yo, yo.
What up, bro?
What's up, man?
Are you recovered from this incredible weekend?
Oh, yeah.
Man, I can't wait to get into it because it was a pretty interesting weekend.
Very
100
interesting.
Way. Can't wait to get into it. Also, we have as our special guest host, he actually is responsible for a number of major tracks that were on the radio stations here in the Bay Area. He's currently the producer for DHR and did work
with
DH. Yeah.
DNH.
I'm sorry. And also with American Idol Sway Pinata.
Yes.
Did he say that right?
This is Sway Pinata.
Yeah. There you go.
Thank you. Yeah. Let's give a big round of applause for JP Nevarez.
What's up, guys? Thanks for having me.
You're welcome,
yes,
man.
Yes.
Sorry for butchering it, but this is a very transparent show, so we cannot press rewind or.
You don't have to apologize for that.
Hey, man.
Maybe for these rainbow headphones that I'm not wearing.
We're going to be Hawaiian headphones.
Okay, it's Hawaiian.
Hawaiian headphones.
That's Fisher Price.
Is this Fisher Price?
Yeah.
as long as you could hear us, that's all good.
I can hear it. And I'll put it on later when I feel a little more comfortable.
All right.
It's all good.
It's all good. Also, we have in the house, I'll go ahead and make it ladies first, is this young, extravagant singer that I actually helped out a few years back, and now she's doing big things. Let's give a big round of applause for Autumn Carter.
Woo! Autumn!
Yeah.
How are you?
I'm great.
Oh, wait, hold on.
There you go.
Yeah, I can't. Oh, grab that. Let's have a little difficulty on the mic there. There you go. I can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Oh,
it's all good. Well, we'll go ahead and go with Dalvin from Jodeci. Can you believe that? Plant the artist in the house. Let's give him a big round.
Thank you.
How you doing?
I'm doing good, man.
Yeah.
It's a pleasure, man. You know, I'm just here, you know, supporting, you know, my fellow artist, Autumn, you know.
Exactly.
We worked, and you know, I'm proud of her, and she just released a video on her single, so I'm proud of what she's doing.
Well, I'm proud of her too, and I think her mic is working. Can I?
Yeah,
can I hear you?
Yes. Hi, everyone.
There you go.
She's back.
See, so she has a whole bunch of like superpowers, just like the Avengers movie that's coming out, and
absolutely.
So let's kind of back up. Stallion, Sage, this past weekend, before we go into any type of topics, we talk about our excursions. Interesting. You want to go to Thursday, or do you want to go
Yeah, well,
Saturday?
Thursday, I set it off at the Club Redux.
Yes.
Like I do every Thursday, and it was cool. It was a good night. We packed it. And then Friday, I chilled and just worked on the music. And then Saturday, met you over at the Club Redux again.
Yes.
And we pulled up, and there was all these tents outside. We're like, what the hell's going on? They close up all the streets, Walnut Creek.
Exactly.
With all these tents. And then we're like, shit, where do we park? Sam, like, cut through, like, the tents.
Yeah, they had some barriers and stuff. And it was like, hey, we got to go ahead and work there. hey, that's part of the whole deal, dude.
Yeah.
We can't park like 1 mile down just because they have these tents and barriers.
Mm-hmm.
It's our job to get, you know, VIP parking. So we got hooked up.
We did. And yeah. And we thought it was going to be a light night at first, you know, because people are like, you know, discouraged when they're driving by and they see these tents blocking the whole street.
Mm-hmm.
They're probably going, damn, I ain't going to walk.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, the house is packed and we
big
rocked
time.
Killed it.
And on Sunday,
we were at the 11th annual New Living Expo in the city.
Yeah.
And it's about just, you know, connecting with nature, and everything is all
spirituality.
Yes,
ETs.
Everything is vegan. I mean, it's just the way to go.
Yeah, that was a good experience.
Yes.
And we actually did a detox there. Yeah, what we had to do was put our feet into these like little bucket things, and they would go ahead and put these little electrodes on our wrists, which enabled our toxins to go from our body out our heels onto this little bucket.
Hmm.
And the bucket was like all mushy.
It was weird.
And
it's a system that actually assists the body to heal itself.
Yeah.
And they didn't put anything in the water. It's just water and salt, and it's an ionic system.
True.
And it's called Alim Tox.
Mm-hmm.
And you can check it out, Alimtox.com.
Yep.
And so it's a $1,300 machine, but
damn,
we
get the hookup over here.
No, we didn't get it.
No. But we did the experience for, you know, a good $40.
Yeah,
and
$40 and it was well worth
and
it.
And it's a good way to detox within 24 hours. And
yeah,
we're going.
Yeah.
So did I take out all your vitamins and everything from the last couple of days?
It shot out everything.
Everything.
Like
yeah.
All the
nitros. What color are your toxins?
Oh, it goes through phases, actually. And we don't want to share ours because it's.
Yeah,
disgusting.
It's kind of like a color code thing that they could kind of distinguish what's what.
Sam said pastos.
So yeah, it was pretty good. So
I thought you put it on. You put the pictures on.
No, I didn't do that.
Okay.
Yeah, because they were pretty gross.
Yeah, it was
because the
gross.
Buckets come out all gooey and stuff like that. I don't want to see no gooey stuff on.
What do you
there.
Feel like afterwards? You feel different, or you just
feel pretty revived?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and actually, I didn't have any appetite for the remainder of the night. It was amazing.
Well, you know why? Because you'd be taking shots of them algae and organic coffees all day.
Yeah, they were giving that away everywhere at all these vendors.
Yes.
So it was a good experience.
So we hit up In-N-Out, and then we'll do that little toxin thing, man.
Can it clear a hangover?
No.
I'm pretty sure it could. Yeah.
Hey, let's back crazy. Up real quick, Sam. The Saturday night, just got to put somebody's on Front Street. Why are all the girls in 2012 starting the fights?
It's part of the whole Mayan thing, dude.
Dude, everyone's
every
time there's a fight,
it's
girls are starting it now.
Yeah.
It's a trip.
Yeah. It's kind of frightening.
Girls are punching dudes and spitting on them, throwing water.
Could it be the alcohol? It has nothing to do with just being women.
No, I mean,
definitely
usually
it has to do
yeah.
with the music, because I was playing old school the last half
yeah,
hour.
It was like
fire. Michael Jackson. If that incites a riot, then we're definitely in a wrong.
Because usually a guy bumps into a guy, you bump me, and they throw down. But now, man, the last couple ones I've seen, this was the first one we've seen in the year at Redux, but it was a girl, actually.
Yeah.
The other clubs I've been to, it's all been girl fights.
Interesting. Yeah.
It's the alcohol.
Ladies being crazy now.
That's why stop drinking alcohol.
There you go. Autumn, Delvin, how was your guys' weekend?
It was cool. You know, we didn't really do much. I flew in from LA
mm-hmm.
and, you know, hooked up with them, came to see you.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's pretty much it.
Just chilled out?
Yeah.
No party?
I was in the studio in LA, but I just, you know, flew out here to support her, like I said.
Okay, cool,
that's,
cool.
Yeah, that's just the main thing I'm out here for.
Nice. JP, what'd you guys do?
Yeah, we were supposed to shoot Sway Pinella's video this weekend, but the girl that we had scheduled to appear on the video couldn't make it. So
Flake.
That's part of the reason why Sway couldn't make it out tonight. So he's sent his apologies. Yeah, so he's out tonight. They're filming it tonight.
Well, maybe it's a blessing in disguise, because now when he comes onto the show, it's a fresh new appearance.
That's right.
He's not rendered to just being in the background.
That's right.
To big
he can actually
right
talk about his stuff.
Yeah. We're going to make him wear the headphones.
A bald dude with rainbow headphones. Yeah.
Man, rainbow. That's Fisher Price. 87.
There you go. Autumn, did you want to tag on in anything, or just chilled out, just prepared
for... This weekend, I actually finished up some music in this studio.
Okay.
Working with the... guy out of New York on writing some stuff for another artist. So
you don't want to mention his name?
Well, he's not a signed artist. A signed artist. Yeah. But we're working on some stuff for them. So tried to finish that up and just kind of hung out.
Nice.
Nothing too exciting.
Okay.
But then I came here, so I'm excited for this.
See, I feel touched because you're preparing yourself spiritually that you want to come on the Slam Show.
That's
100%.
Right.
aim for fire.
Yes.
That's right. That's beautiful thing. All right. That closes out the intro for the Slam Show. We're going to go ahead and take a quick music. Excuse me. Not music break yet. We got a lot of music coming up. A commercial break. And we're going to start off with the sports segment here. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Yeah, welcome back to the Slam Show. This is a sport segment sponsored by Liquid Nitro. Real energy,
no bull-ish.
And also BayManda.com for all your printing needs. Wow, we got the freaking chat room just blowing up right now. Just a few people I want to go ahead and give a shout out to. The Terrence Show from Alabama. We have Tierra from Illinois. We got Daimu. I believe it's Daimu from Chi-Town. Anyone wants to shout, go ahead and put in your full name. I'll try to get it in on the next break. So, as we always go into the sports segment, I throw in a little video of what's coming up on the topic end. And what we have is basically the NBA playoffs. Let's cut it real short and tight, guys. Who do you think is going to win the championship this year? I want to go straight to my special guest co-host, JP. give some insight. You don't have to say exactly who's going to win it all. Just kind of like give a rough evaluation on the playoffs and its generalization.
Well, I think this was a great first week, first games. Mm-hmm. From the Clippers coming back on the Grizzlies, Bynum's triple-double.
Blocks, huh?
Yeah,
can't believe
just
that?
Crazy. It was a crazy first. I didn't even know who won the Heat game tonight.
I haven't even checked the scores yet.
Yeah. I'm pretty excited about it. But my pick, do you want me to tell you who I think
is going to go right ahead.
I'm going to pick San Antonio.
San Antonio?
I think it has to be. Yeah.
Spurs?
They were embarrassed last year, man. They were embarrassed last year, and I don't know, in the West at least, I don't think anyone's balling as well as they are. Mm-hmm. I think my personal opinion is, look at Dallas just looking like, hell no. I think that the injury to Ginobili early in the season really helped that team.
Yeah, messed up my fantasy team.
Yeah, was he one of your guys?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I mean, you had guys like Bonner and, you know, what's that, Tiago, mm-hmm. and, you know, all those guys. They got play, and it gave Popovich the opportunity to tinker around with the team. And
yeah.
So now you've got a fresh Ginobili. You've got, you know, Tony Parker playing at the top of his game right now. That's an MVP candidate right now.
That's right.
And, you know, the big fundamental, is in there, too. I mean,
Mr. Duncan.
It's kind of hard to want to root for OKC. Mm-hmm. But, man, if Durant and Westbrook are off, they've shown that they fold, man. You saw what happened against the Lakers.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. It's tough. But I'm going to go San Antonio.
Okay. Yeah. Sage, what's your pick for NBA championship?
The Heat.
Just like that?
The Heat. Triple threat. Wade.
Mm-hmm.
Bosch.
Right.
And James. And let's not forget the half Filipino coach.
Ooh, there you go.
There you go. I'm going to go with that.
All right. Stallion, who's your pick for the NBA champion right now?
I don't really watch basketball, but I'll say Chicago.
Oh, okay.
Wow. Even after the Rose injury, huh?
Hey, man. They gotta be coming back.
Hey, you never know. Anything's possible, but that's pretty much a stretch right there. Delvin, you got a pick?
I would go with Sage with the Heat, but I would say Oklahoma is really doing good right now, but they lack experience.
Mm-hmm.
And as much as I don't like the Lakers have experience in how to win.
True.
You know, so... I'll probably go with the Heat. That's what I would like to see, the Heat.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But they always fold, you know, and they always fold in the finals. So, I mean, I don't know. It's like, so. But I would like to see the Heat go all the way.
And I would venture to say the Miami Heat as well. I think it's their time.
Yeah, I think it's their time. And I think that, you know, but it's just that they, you know, they depend too much. And it's hard because I play basketball, so it's hard to just, you know, to put Dwayne Wade and LeBron James on the same floor at the same time. Cause mm-hmm.
There's only one ball, dude.
Yeah, there's only one ball. That's what I'm saying. It's only one ball, so it's hard for them to distribute the ball the way they should, though. But, you know, I think they will get it together, hopefully this year.
Yeah.
You know, because they've had plenty of opportunity to do it, you know.
That's true.
So,
yeah.
I'd probably go with the Heat. I would like to see the Heat.
Yeah, same here.
But if I had to bet some money, I'd probably say the Lakers would probably go.
If you had to bet some money.
If I had to bet some money, because, you know, they always figure out how to win. even though Kobe would take 1,000 shots and make 20, okay. 22.
Okay.
You know, they always end up winning some kind of way.
All right, let me pull out my 5Gs right now and put you on.
And Monopoly money?
Exactly. So, yeah, I'll go ahead and go with the Heat. I
go with the Heat, too.
I think it's LeBron and Dwayne's time. And what's really unfortunate is how all these injuries have played out, what JP was referring to.
You know what, though? Not to cut you off.
Go ahead.
But I would have said Chicago until Derrick Rose got hurt, though.
Yeah. Well, you could be like Stallion and go along with
it. I would have said Chicago, but, I mean, now that he's hurt, I mean, the team don't stand. They don't stand a chance without Derrick Rose, though. That's just the bottom line.
Yeah, that's just like the Lakers without Kobe. Yeah, without Kobe.
They don't stand a chance.
You know, I saw a stat that the Chicago Bulls only played 15 games this entire season with their starting five.
That's
so they have a shot in the East. If you look at the East, I think they have a real shot. And at least get into the Eastern Finals.
There you go. You're giving Stallion some hope right there.
Yeah,
let's make it science.
You look at it like this, though. Every team needs a leader when it comes to.
That's true.
Every team needs a leader. I mean,
that's true.
You can win. But I mean, that's like us all going play 5-on-5 pickup games at the park.
Right, right.
You know what I'm saying? We're going to win a couple of games. We're going to win some games. But at the end of the day, we got to have a leader that lead the team. You feel what I'm saying?
When the chips are right down and everything's on the line.
Exactly.
You need that guy.
You need
that's true.
That's it.
Hey, D, didn't you do a song for Above the Rim?
Yeah, I did.
The movie Speaking of Basketball?
Yeah, I did.
Back in 94?
Yes, I did.
There you go.
There you go.
Yep. Above the Rim, I did do.
Well, there you go. The Heat of the Rim.
That's
my 5Gs.
There you go.
I was just thinking basketball. I think Above the Rim. Yeah, the movie.
Yeah, I did do a song Above the Rim. Yeah, I did.
Song for that.
Yeah, I did. Actually, I did.
Cool, cool. Moving on to our next topic. Guess what? Calvin Johnson, a.k.a. Megatron of the Detroit Lions, JP's already shaking his head, has won the Madden 13 cover. Wow. And we all know what that means. Sage, obviously.
I picked him last week.
You did?
I did.
Yeah.
You voted for him?
Yes.
Well, we know that means that means he's gonna be injured next year. Y'all know what that means.
Well,
he'll be sitting the next season out.
I mean, he is the number one receiver in fantasy, number one receiver technically in real life NFL football, and I don't know, JP. I think if there's gonna be one player that could break this curse, I have a gut feeling it could be Calvin Johnson because when it comes down to it, when you become the cover guy for Madden, there's a lot of like outside pressures, and I think he's such a laid back, just down to earth type of guy, he could just deflect on that. What's your thought on it?
I think the dude's in trouble.
I think he's in trouble too.
Man,
come on, man, I need someone to side on me.
the curse is the curse.
I know that, but
it should have been DeSean Jackson.
No,
really?
No, he was my fantasy guy. Leave him alone.
He should have been on the cover, though. I mean, that dude's incredible. I'm glad it wasn't Michael Vick because he's my favorite quarterback of all time. But I'm glad it wasn't him. He's already been hurt. Let's leave him alone. But it should have been DeSean Jackson.
Really?
I think so. That's my pick.
Yeah, because you're saying you believe in a curse. So
I believe in the curse. Yeah, That's what I said.
So you want DeSean Jackson to eventually get injured?
I don't. I really don't. But I'm just saying, like, okay, this is just like you said, the curse might be broken. Okay, let's break the curse. I think DeSean Jackson deserved that cover, though.
Okay.
Like, that's what I think, though. I don't want him to get injured, though.
I'm on your side, Slam.
Okay.
Only because he's Megatron. Who else is going to stop Megatron but Megatron?
That's true.
So
right.
He is a dominant player, and he's young. I don't know. I just wish him the best. But, JP, would you pick on your fantasy team Megatron? Oh,
man.
Be honest.
He's a keeper on my team, so I probably still would. I mean, even with the Madden curse.
I don't think he's going to reveal who he chooses for his fantasy. Come on.
Yeah.
So, who's your favorite quarterback?
In fantasy or in real life?
In real life.
In real life, Alex Smith. Just kidding.
Wow.
Gotcha. No,
he was playing him earlier.
Wow. Yeah, and I killed that guy online. That's a very good question. There's a lot of people that I really like, a lot of quarterbacks that I really like, but if you want it hands down, the number one guy is Drew Brees. Flat out.
I wouldn't argue with that. He's a great quarterback.
Yeah.
versus Michael Vick, though?
I still pick Drew Brees.
Over Michael Vick?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I mean, you know.
And we could try it out. If you're a good man, we could go ahead and get a game.
You know what? You know what? I'll be honest with you. I was good at Madden in 09, bro. And I haven't played, like, I got every one of them, but I haven't even played. My nephew's really good. He's been at all kind of Madden tournaments, won trophies. But I haven't really had time to sit down and just play it because there's so many things that go into Madden right now. Like,
it's pretty intricate, man.
Yeah, it's really intricate right now. So you don't even have time to just sit there and, like, study everything, like the quarterback focus and everything. Like, you know, they changed the game so much.
Yeah, yeah.
And I haven't had time to just really sit down and focus on it like I used to.
Right, right. So I'll give you an hour to practice and we'll play.
You know what, though, I will do? I'll get my nephew to play.
Okay.
I get my nephew to play. Okay. He's really good.
Give him your code, Sam. Yeah. Give him your screen name.
Yeah. But he's online, too, all the time. He plays online all the time.
Okay, I'll get his tag. And
okay, I'll give it to you.
Is it Xbox or PlayStation?
I think he plays PlayStation. He plays on PlayStation. Perfect. But I'll give you his tag and everything.
All right. I'll hold you to that after the show.
Okay. We're going to record it, too.
Yeah, we'll record it and play it on the
I can almost guarantee he's going to whoop you. He's really good.
All right.
Y'all are gonna get the headset and like you be there to talk smack to him. But he's doing it. Don't talk, just listen.
Don't talk.
Right on. Yeah. Closing out the sports segment is another football note, which is the San Francisco 49er draft. Wow. Oh, everyone in here are pretty much 49er fans, I think, except for Mr. Dalvin, right?
You know, I like the 49ers. I mean, you know, I go way back with, you know, Joe Montana, you know, everybody, you know.
That's
I go
it?
With Jerry Rice.
Give me more names, man. Everyone knows Joe Montana.
Jerry Rice. I mean, I go back with all of them.
He likes the old school.
Yeah, I mean, but, you know, 49ers are good because, I mean, I've always been a Dallas Cowboy fan. You know, Tony Dorsett gave me his jersey off his back.
Really?
And signed it for me. I still got it. You know what I'm saying? So
you didn't eBay it yet?
No, I'm never going to eBay it. I mean, he signed it all over. So, you know, that's my favorite running back of all time.
Okay.
You know, so, I mean, I've been a fan of his since I was a kid.
Yeah.
You know, and I met him. I got the chance to meet him in a Dallas Cowboy game, and he gave me a jersey off his back.
Wow.
And funny story. I met O.J. Simpson after all the trial and stuff happened. I had a chance to go to his house, and he asked me, who is your favorite running back of all time? And I was like, and I couldn't lie to him. I was like, Tony Dorsett. He's like, oh, really? I mean, he got really bothered. So we went in the house, and he put on all his tapes. But I forgot how incredible of a running back he was, though.
Mm.
I forgot. Like, he showed me all his tapes. Like, can Tony Dorsett do that? Did he do it? Then he showed me his Hertz commercial.
Yeah, where he's hopping over the bag.
Yeah, over the turnbuckle. And yeah. I was just laughing, man. So
are you sure you the Naked Gun movies too?
Yeah, but you know that's one of my favorite movies though.
Yeah,
that's a classic.
And they pushing him down the stairs.
Yeah, when they shot him up and everything.
That's crazy.
Yeah. So.
Well, getting back to the Niner draft picks, JP, what'd you think of it?
I'm happy with it. I mean, you know, I'm not a big draft fan because I don't think it's an exact science. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I think I would have liked to see them take a guard.
Right.
You know, just because we lost was Snyder. But I'm happy. You know, I don't know that our receiver is necessarily going to be a starting receiver, but, you know, he's fast. He was top four at the 40-yard at the combine. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we could probably use him in the slot.
And
as a kick returner, too. Yeah, yeah.
LaMichael James, second rounder, running
back.
Yeah,
you know, a lot of people are saying that he's a lot like Sproles.
Yeah.
Kind of that little shifty guy. And it's, you know, kind of a nice change of pace. So, you know, our runners are kind of north-south type guys. So it'll be interesting to see how they put him in the mix, especially with Brandon Jacobs there now. You got Hunter still there. You got Gore. I don't know how he's going to get played, at least this first season. So.
Well, I think the good thing is that they're stocking up on explosive talent.
Yeah.
And
let
the best
fast.
Man win. And there's nothing wrong with having a surplus of talent on your team, regardless of positions being filled and starters already in the exact position to move on.
I think they're just uber smart to stock up all the arsenal because they have all those players to back up Smith.
That's true. You got to have explosive players to be effective because last year they were going into halftime with, 14-0 leads when they could have been easily 28-35-0 leads. But they didn't have the explosive players to go ahead and execute. So we'll see what happens. I'm looking forward to a big season. Did you like your draft? Because you're a Cowboy fan, right, Dalvin?
Well, you know, to be honest, I kind of drifted away from the Cowboys and kind of went to the Eagles because Tony Romo, I'm just not a fan of Tony Romo.
No, me neither.
It's like I try to rock with him for a minute, and it's like I tried, and it's like, man, you know what, man? And I've been a Cowboy fan my whole life, but I had to just, you know, let me just go until they figure it out. Figure the quarterback situation out because they really don't have it right now.
You'll just go back once they get
I'll go back. Yeah, I've been a Cowboy fan my whole life, but he just drove me away.
You don't want Tony Dorsett to be hearing this, right?
I don't. I hope he's not listening.
Especially the Eagles, huh? They're like the biggest rival.
I know. But you know what? I'm not really an Eagles fan. I just like Michael Vick.
Right, right.
You know what I'm saying?
So wherever he goes, you're going to go.
If
he goes to the Arena League, you're gonna still be a Michael Vick fan, right?
Yeah,
I'm just a big Michael. You know, it's like NBA. Like my favorite player was Allen Iverson.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? First was Michael Jordan, but it's not like I'm a ship jumper, but it's like, you know, I just have favorite players now because everybody's a journeyman now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everybody just go from team to team, so it's hard for you to keep up.
Right, right.
You feel what I'm saying? I'm from North Carolina, so they got the Bobcats. You know they suck.
Yeah.
I mean, the Bobcats suck, and we all know that.
And Michael Jordan owns that team. Wow.
And Michael Jordan's my favorite player of all time ever stepped on the floor. And I had I have the privilege to hang out with Michael Jordan a few times.
Really?
A few times. We've got drunk together a couple times.
Really?
But what I'm saying is,
give me some dirt.
it's not dirt. but I'm just saying, He needs to pick the right players to play for his team because he's smart enough to know basketball. He's the greatest basketball player ever lived. So get the right players to play on your team. You feel what I'm saying?
I really don't know what the hell he's thinking.
Just come out of his back pocket.
I don't know what he's thinking either, though. I mean, I can't even name one Bobcat player. Can you?
Corey McGetty.
Is he still on the team?
McGetty's not even on the team anymore, is he?
He's hurt. He's injured, right?
So, I mean, he got good players, but he needs, like I said, once again, he needs leadership.
Yeah, he needs structure. There's no structure on the team.
But the team, I mean, he got some good players, but he just needs, like, that leadership. Like, he should have got Allen Iverson. When Allen Iverson was coming to North Carolina, he should have put him on the team.
Allen's nuts big time on this one.
Allen's nuts, nope. he's a good friend of mine, and I enjoy to watch him play, and he has star power to bring people to the arena.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
You still think that Allen still has a little bit left in the tank?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Most definitely.
He's just getting blackballed right now from the league.
Yeah, exactly.
And he wants to play still, right?
Yeah, he's still going to play. Yeah. I mean, and he still got it, though. I watched him play, like, when he was overseas. I mean, he was still going off. But, you know, I think he would bring, like, a lot of star power because he has that. I mean, even though he might be a little, you know, a headache.
Yeah.
But he still brings that star power to the team.
Man, I want
to
bring back all the old school players. I want to bring back Dennis Rodman. I want to bring Rasheed Wallace.
Oh,
all
man,
these
he's
guys.
Going way back. They probably in wheelchairs.
Yeah, in basketball years.
Spud Webb. You got him out of
Yeah. Oh, I got a name for it. Muggsy Bogues.
Oh, Muggsy. He lives in Charlotte. He lives in my hometown.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he does. He lives in Charlotte.
Have you met him?
Yeah, I met Muggsy.
Man.
Yeah, I met Muggsy.
Mr. Dalvin's just meeting every single person. Someone in the chat room, everyone. Give me a name that he possibly has not met, please.
That's probably, you probably can't name anybody that has a name that I haven't met. But, I mean, you know, I've been around the world, man. I sold 35 million records, man. So it's like, we done been all around. We done toured and everything. I'm about to do it again, so. It's
all man.
Good, you know.
I can't wait till we get into the interview segment because we got a lot to talk about with Mr. Dalvin and obviously the lovely Autumn Carter.
Make
all this new music stuff happen.
Exactly.
Right. It's going to be incredible.
Yes,
all right.
It is.
We're going to go ahead and take a quick music break and be back with the entertainment segment here on the Slam Show. Everyone, hang tight.
Okay. Yeah.
You know better than your other man. I'm better than I ever been. I take you to the Netherlands, flying, I can never land. Never ever ever land. I take a rose petal and she love me not. Shorty, when I hold you, can so yeah, hold you tight. See, I can make you fall in love with me overnight. Turn you over and roll you like a motorbike, and then I kiss you. I know you like, know you like. And she go dumb with it like she from Frisco. Yeah, beat some dog in the bedroom. Get her all alone and you knowin' what she gon' do. And I'm with 2 Chainz and you know that we bang. If you do me, your girl just gotta do the whole game. Don't call me, mama, I'ma call you. And we gon' see what you came to do. It ain't no fun, so I call them corrupt too. And you know my big cousin Snoop coming too. Dog pound, dog down, wrap your hood back. We be on that hood, you be tryna holler back. You having a good time, yeah, you excited. Don't matter, don't lick it, don't bite it, excited. I like it. It up, wipe it down, show her what it's all about. Make a circle with your mouth, all around, all around. I could show her what it's about, things she love to do it out. Things she love with her mouth, up and down. Cause I'll kiss her where I know you like, know you like. Hitting the club, sipping something, staying overnight. Over here, we ball rich overnight. I lay her down, then I kiss her where I know she like.
Come and kiss upon me.
And I know you like. I do anything right when I'm laying pipe. I do anything right, anything she like. Something about a boss when you hit the lane. I'm too clean, I'm so sharp. Titty 2 Chainz, see him pulling up. She got a cat stacks and she trim. Got like Kim Kardashian.
Yeah, that's a little Dog Pound featuring 2 Chainz, where I know you like, brand new track here on the Slam Show. You guys feeling that?
Yeah, that was slapping.
Yeah, I like that. I like that.
Yeah, yeah. This is the entertainment segment sponsored by Perfect Tan and Kinders, providing the great sandwiches we have to dine after the show. Thank you, Mr. Stallion, for taking care of that for
us. No problem, man.
All right.
Got a big mat out there in Kinders.
There you go. There you go. Our first topic on the entertainment segment. This is pretty interesting, and Autumn kind of like, whoa, really? Yeah, this is actually true. Over in Santa Ana, there are actual marijuana.
Is he drunk?
Vending machines. Believe that.
Is he drunk? All kinds of stuff.
Now, check this out.
He had a sample.
For some reason or another, this medicinal marijuana place was able to authorize a vending machine where you could just go ahead and put in an ATM type card and get your special.
That's crazy.
Your special kush. Now, Mr. Dalvin, what do you think about this machinery, and what other things can we absolutely put on the table as far as in a vending machine? Who wants to chime in first?
Well, you know, to be honest, as far-fetched as this may seem, I've never even smoked marijuana. I've never even tried it. I mean, most of my friends do, but I've never smoked, so I don't really know. Like, I can't really speak on the topic because I don't really know about it, though.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I don't really know about it.
Well, see, the availability of this is just now, it's already past the point of no return. What else can we go ahead and throw into vending machines if we're allowed to have marijuana? JP?
Well, this isn't my idea, but you guys ever see in Japan, you go like the train stations there, and I think you know what I'm saying. They got those vending machines there, and this is sick, but you can buy girls' panties. And they've been worn.
There's
a chick out there, yeah.
And do what with them, though?
I don't know.
Wait, they're selling used panties?
Used panties, yeah.
You gotta be kidding me.
Maybe to hide the marijuana you buy from another vending machine. I don't know. But yeah.
Maybe so. I mean, what, you gonna just sniff them all day?
I think that's what they do, man.
Japanese people are
crazy. I don't know.
You can buy pre-owned panties, man.
Yeah. You said panties, JP. All right, that's cool. You know, it's clean air, but then you're saying it's worn.
Yeah.
Smoking. Freaky shit.
Yeah,
that's all
exactly.
I gotta say. Real
man.
Freaky.
Yeah. So that's why this doesn't really, you know, faze me, because
yeah.
I heard this, I seen this in Japan.
What happened to just buying a soda?
I just want to get some Cheetos.
You can't buy a soda no more.
You got dumb fuck up. I'm gonna clone somebody out there with a pig.
Yeah, exactly.
Got him money.
Oh no, ladies. What would be a cool thing from a dispenser of that nature that you would like to see?
Well, you know, a weird, I don't like to see this, but a weird one that I've heard is you can actually buy Botox injections.
Mm.
Yes. That's scary to me.
Out of a vending machine?
Out of a vending machine.
So are you supposed to inject yourself?
You're supposed
to
inject yourself.
Or does a needle come out and do it for you?
Like, in here.
Yeah. Robot arm.
I don't know who would be brave enough to do that, but yeah, that was a weird one for me.
Wow. Wow. Botox injections.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah. Sage?
When are they going to start? When are they going to put women in the vending machine? We can go buy them. We can just go, you know, put like $20 in.
They do it in Amsterdam. They got the window.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the red light district. I'm talking about a vending machine.
Okay, I'm not a pervert. I don't use this type of thing, but I would think a sex toy should be good.
They got those.
Yeah, they got those already, though.
They
got the iPhones.
Yeah, you know about iPhone.
Talk about sex
and the iBone.
They have iPhones.
iBone.
they do?
I don't know.
That's what I want them to start selling.
Okay.
Not that I use it, but that'd be cool.
Okay.
So you get mad at Sam, you'd be like, I want to buy this one.
Yeah.
The number 13.
I'm going to 7-Eleven. Get me something.
That's out of the...
Yeah.
Box, don't
I mean,
you think?
Everything now is being automated through these vending machines. You have obviously Redbox.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. You took the words out of my mouth. Like, you know, Redbox closed, Blockbuster down. You know, you can get anything almost out of vending machine.
You can even buy Proactive out of vending machine.
Yeah, you can buy anything.
Exactly.
Like Sam said, you can buy iPhones. You can buy anything. iPods, iPads.
Yeah.
You can buy anything.
Macy's, they got everything in there.
Yeah.
You got them in the malls and everything now.
It's just like this whole Best Buy going out of business. Pretty soon,
yeah,
these brick and mortar places.
Best Buy's going out of business? I didn't know that.
Certain stores are
yes,
closing.
Yes, the one in Pittsburgh.
You can buy a TV.
Circuit City went out of business. All of them.
CompUSA, remember that?
Yeah, they went out of business too?
Yeah.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Where have you been?
Man, I must have been on the rocks somewhere. I know CompUSA went out of business.
Yeah.
I know Circuit City did, though. I didn't know.
Yeah. So, basically, we just have to have these vending machines provide us with the real needs, not these weird needs. That's all I got to say on
that. Right.
Plain and simple.
Absolutely.
Moving on to the next topic. Did you guys hear about that he was kind of bored because of his ankle injury?
Yeah, I heard about it.
Yeah.
What happened?
It was like some kind of sexual, weird sex track. Some kind of sex track.
Yeah, it has to do with how to teach you to do your... JP, help me out with this.
Why you make me say it?
It's the P word, the G word for the women. How's that?
I heard about it.
And it is pretty explicit. But what I'm kind of... shocked is it's coming from Brightman.
You can't even take that seriously, though.
Yeah,
I mean, really, man, you ain't even known for that, though. Like,
that's the thing.
That ain't your thing, bro. You should have known. I mean, he must have been bored or either drunk or high or something, but that ain't even his thing, though. Like, you can't take it serious. It's like I tell people all the time, all my friends do music. Put quality music out there that represents you. That don't represent you.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And you know, the songs that you do, that represents you. You know what I'm saying? Don't put out music that don't represent you and try to change.
I hear that.
You know, that's all I say, man.
Well, he actually came out and said it was a joke.
Right.
It's still representing you.
Yeah, he came out and said it was a joke because everybody made him a joke by doing it.
That's true.
You know what I'm saying? That's what
his reaction.
Yeah, they tried to clean it up. But don't do that, though. Why would you put a joke out?
Yeah.
You know, if you want to, you want to put a joke out, get a comedian to put on, be on the track.
Yeah.
So he should be held kind of responsible for the content of what he put out. Is that what you're saying?
I mean, as a musician and an artist, you should. You got to be.
But see, we expect like the two live crew.
You expect that. Funny when they do it. But Brian McKnight, come on, man.
Maybe he's just trying to get attention.
Maybe so.
Well,
maybe
just
so.
To be relevant or
well,
something.
Well, let's go ahead and cut to the chase. The culture of music is way different from how it was back
right,
then.
Exactly.
So there's a lot of crossover themes that were taboo before that you could get away with now.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I mean, it could seem kind of outrageous, like, okay, Brian McKnight is doing an X-rated song, but then after a while, we could go to YouTube and find like 20 million people doing the exact same thing.
Yeah, and you look at it like this too, though. I mean, like, you look at, like, my band could do something like that because we came out and we set our stature of what we were.
Mm-hmm.
The Bad Boys R&B, we can pretty much do what we want. Brian McKnight didn't come out like this. So don't try to change the game after you done been in here in the game for 20 years. Don't try to change the game up because you look stupid. That's the bottom line. That's just the bottom line.
That's right.
You know, and it's like as a musician, you got to know where your niche is. And if it's a joke, like I said, get a comedian to do it so that everybody can laugh with you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You were serious, but everybody took you as a joke. So then you try to make it a joke, but it's too late, though.
Okay, so we're under the agreement that he tried to be serious okay.
Everybody started clowning for it, so he tried to come out make it like it was a joke, but it wasn't a joke.
Gotcha. What's the name of the song? I haven't heard it.
Man, do you want me to say it?
Say it, Sam.
It's called If You're Ready to Learn How to Work Your Pussy or something like that.
Oh,
and
wow.
And that's Brian McKnight. Really, man. Like you
that's
even
ridiculous.
Listening to it, like, it's really like, really, man, come on, man.
I'm with Autumn. I've never heard it. I don't think I do because I really like Brian McKnight. Does he sing it really suave or is it dirty?
It's in his Brian McKnight tone.
That doesn't even sound right.
The names don't even go together.
He's got the piano and the turtleneck.
Yeah, he got the piano and the kooji sweater. And the church shoes on.
Oh, no, the church shoes.
His pants are not any long.
No, exactly.
Floods.
Yeah.
He's a flood.
Maybe he's going for more current sound. I don't know.
I mean, he sang that song we did last week, Sam, in your neck.
I don't know. He could have always done it like under a different alias and kind of like let that float out there and see what happens.
Exactly. I mean, you could have did anything, but
or
like
just not put it out.
Just not put it out. Like, you know what I'm saying? I wrote it for somebody else.
That's true.
You know, wrote it for somebody else and let them put it out. You know?
Brian McKnight screwed up. We're under the
big time.
I'm not saying he screwed up big time. I'm just saying, like, you know, sometimes artists, you know, they do things and sometimes we all make mistakes, though. I mean, like, you know, we'll do things and we regret them later. But, you know, that's just what an artist is, though.
That's
you know
right.
What I'm saying? That's what it is.
And it's all for headlines because, look, right when he did it, it went on TMZ, which is the biggest gossip site on the planet.
Exactly.
Hey, and it's all information because keep in mind, we're in the information age where whatever's gossip now is old news in 2 days.
It's old news in 2 days.
So in all actuality, maybe that's the whole structure of things.
I just think it's a little bit unfortunate because he's actually one of the few artists that are extremely talented and people really respect him.
Absolutely.
And he doesn't need to do those kinds of things to be great. You know, people love him for who he is.
Yeah.
And you know, and what's unfortunate too is like nowadays you got to be so careful the things you do because you lose a lot of like endorsements. You lose a lot of things. You lose a lot of things that, you know, white America. They grant us. Because we don't make mistakes like that. He's the type of dude, his image is so clean, so it's easy for him to get things done.
Right.
And doing stuff like that, that really hurts you, though.
Yeah, now he can't go to Cash Creek Casino and do his performance.
Damn, I wanted to see him, too.
Yeah, he can't sing back at 101, but like back door.
Yeah, 101. JP?
I mean, but you know what,
that's
though?
Neck of the woods.
It's my spot.
Oh, that's your spot?
Yeah.
Well, he'll be okay. He'll be okay, though. I mean,
he'll
be okay.
Back.
He'll bounce back.
It's just shocking.
That's true. I mean, it's like I said, it's gossip news now.
And we're talking about it, so it's relevant.
So we'll catch him at the Antioch Fair, and then we'll have him on the show.
Oh, wow, the Antioch Fair. Robin's like, oh, I remember that. All right. We're going to go ahead and take a quick music break and be back with our exclusive interviews with Autumn and Dalvin.
Yeah.
Everyone hang tight here on...
Yeah. Yes, all the traffic in the world can replace you.
Short and Jodeci.
Yeah.
Mr. Dalvin. Didn't you say you wrote that or had something to do with that
hook?
Yeah,
no, I helped Casey write that hook right there.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Golly. We still play that track.
Yeah, I put it on Thursday, dude. People went crazy.
I appreciate that, man.
Right on, right on. Okay, this is the exclusive interview with our special guest, Autumn Carter and Mr. Dalvin of Jodeci. We're going to go ahead and start off with Autumn Carter. Just to give you a little brief summary, I've known this young lady ever since she was just so high when she came into the studio, just as a raw talent that I just knew was going to blossom into just extraordinary accomplishments. One notable is being able to go on Showtime at the Apollo, which everyone knows is could be a very great situation or a very hostile situation at times. But let's go ahead and give a big round of applause once again for Autumn Carter.
Thank you for having me on your show, Sam.
Well, I'm glad that you're able to come on, and let me know if you have any mic problems because I'll adjust it real quick.
All right, we should be okay.
All right. Well, let's go ahead and back up. Let's talk about where you're originally from and how you got into music and all that.
Okay, I'm originally from Southern California. I grew up in Rancho Cucamonga. Mm-hmm. And at the age of 4 is when my musical journey sort of began. I used to love watching musicals as a kid, mm-hmm. and one of my favorite musicals was Annie. And I came home from school one day and I told my parents, I said, I want to sing like Annie, you know, I want to do that. And I asked them if they could find me a play so that I could do this. And my school was doing a little talent show. So they said, well, if we put you in the talent show and you sing Annie, you know, we'll find you a play. So I got up on the stage and I did it. I sang Tomorrow from Annie. Mm-hmm. And they were able to find me a musical. So actually, my start was in musical theater. And from then, it just kind of evolved to dancing and singing and acting. I started doing everything. I went to a performing arts studio, and it was called Carly Moultrie Performing Arts, and that was in Upland, California. Mm-hmm. And a few years later, I ended up moving to the Bay Area, and I moved to Antioch. And that's where I met you.
That's right.
Yeah, and I started doing some recording and some writing and more performing, and then it just kind of blossomed and blossomed and blossomed to where I am now.
Perfect, yeah. Perfect. So basically, you moved out the area. You're no longer in Antioch.
I'm no longer in Antioch. I now live in Reno, Nevada.
Now, how did that move come together? Was it more because of certain circumstances, or you felt there were opportunities in that area?
I definitely didn't move to Reno for the opportunity. At that time, I was still in high school. My mm-hmm. dad's job had actually transferred him to Reno.
Okay.
So I, you know, went with my family, and I decided to stay after high school. I went to the University of Nevada, Reno. I got some music scholarships to go there. So I actually stayed there for school, and I didn't like it in the beginning. It was definitely not my favorite place, but I've met a lot of people there, and it was able to take me out of my comfort zone, and I've been able to grow. And the good thing is it's not too far from the Bay Area. It's mm-hmm. not too far from LA. It's just about an hour flight away. So I'm still able to, you know, be active and do what I love.
So be flat out straight up honest. Were you very upset to move out of the Bay Area?
Oh, my God. Words cannot describe how upset I was. And then when I moved to Reno, it's so different. It's like city and then country.
Right,
like
right.
Out there, people have horses. Like, what do you have a horse for? In my, where I'm from, the horse would get ran over by a car. Like, we don't do that. You know? Yeah, so I wasn't happy at all. You know, but good things have came from that move, so I'm thankful.
Mm-hmm. And that's good. That's good. And I believe everything happens for a reason.
Right.
Regardless of the demographic or changes of that sort, you're able to make the most of the transition. And
yes.
It's exploded. Let's kind of back up a little bit to the whole Showtime at the Apollo situation.
Okay.
How did you get picked, and how did that all evolve?
I actually, my parents have always managed me, mm-hmm. even as a kid, and even now they do. And there was an audition that they had sent me to when I was like 12 years old, and it was for Apollo Kids. And I actually didn't even win the audition. They only pick one winner, mm-hmm. and I didn't win the audition. And I was so hurt, because I've always would watch that show with my mom, and I was like, I want to do this so bad. Yeah. And my mom's thing was always, if you can make it on the Apollo, then you made it. Like, if you can win that crowd, you can win anything.
That's true.
So, you know, I really wanted to win, and I went to this audition, and they picked some other kid. And the producers from the show came up to me after the audition was over and said, you know, we can only pick one winner, but we got to have you on. So I was still able to...
Really? So they kind of like bent some rules to...
They kind of bent some rules to get me on.
Yeah.
And I was so excited. But the performance itself, I've never been more scared in all of my life.
Yeah. Because you watch, there's a whole bunch of hoopla, and what we're seeing the viewer is, because it's Apollo Kids, so they're going to kind of, you know, dampered a little bit.
Yeah, they tone it down on TV, but it's still pretty rowdy.
Really?
It's pretty rowdy in Harlem.
Do they still boo the kids?
They do.
Oh, wow.
They do.
They boo the kids?
They don't show that part, but they do.
Oh, that's demoralizing.
Yeah, that's on TV, because they always say, don't boo them now.
Yeah, they say don't boo, but that crowd does what they want to do. They do what they want to do. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why I was so scared, because I was going there with the expectation of, it's totally fine. Even if I don't do my best, it's okay. I'm a kid. They can't boo me. But, yeah. Oh, no, no, no. They do what they want. But
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I thought they protected the kids. My goodness. It's like, oh, we'll throw you into the fire. Whatever happens, happens.
I remember right before I went on, there was a little girl. She did like a little tap dance something. Uh-huh. I think she did. I think she was a little tap dancer. And she ran off the stage crying. Didn't even finish.
What?
Didn't even finish what she... you know, her number, and I'm like, oh my god, I have to go on next. I don't want this to happen. Oh god. But I did it. It was amazing. I sang I Believe I Can Fly.
Yes.
And
I do remember that.
You remember
that whole episode? Yeah.
Yeah. It was after after it's over, I'm like, whew, I can breathe. It's done. They loved it. I didn't get booed. Mm. So I'm like, I did this, now I can conquer the world.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go. Would you go back right now and do it?
Of course.
Okay.
Of course. If I did it once, I think I could do it again.
Oh, just trying to make sure that you still have that, all right, I'm at a level now where I'm totally invincible. I won't ever worry about getting bulled over at the Apollo.
They got to do a reunion show with all the kids that did back in the day and bring them back.
There you go. Yeah.
Did you rub the tree stump or whatever that thing is?
Oh, yeah.
You did?
Yeah, you got to rub the tree. And they remind you before you go on, make sure you rub the tree.
Is that supposed to be like bad luck if you don't, right?
Yes, if you don't, it's bad luck.
If you sanitize your hands, that's not good. Out there. You got to keep it dirty.
Yeah, because I've seen people like...
Kiss it?
Walk past it, then run
forget
back
it.
And
yeah.
touch it, because they want to make sure that they got the good blessing and good aura from it.
Yeah.
Interesting. So, that was way back. Now you've kind of developed yourself into an adult.
Yeah.
And kind of molding yourself into this incredible artist of yours. Who are recording artists right now that you really look up to and kind of like say, that's what I want to try to emulate or kind of picture myself as?
Artists that I am inspired by, right now I really love Adele. I love how, you know, she's definitely something that's different right now. She uses her voice.
Yeah.
And I respect that so much. But other influences are Brandy, of course, Whitney Houston.
Yeah.
I mean, how could she not be one?
Yeah, were you devastated when...
Oh my gosh. I actually found out because Dalvin text messaged me, and I go, what? What? I was just out and about, like, shopping, doing something, and he text messaged me and said, Whitney Houston just died, and I go, what? I'm like, this can't be true. This is a rumor. Then you go into the car, and it's all on the radio, and I'm like, oh, my gosh. How can this happen? So, yeah, I was definitely devastated by that. She was such a huge influence on me as a child and even now.
Right, right. Yeah. That's stardom for you.
That
there's
happens.
A lot of pressure and everything, but now that you're working with Mr. Dalvin, there's a lot of things he could share, things that you can do, what you shouldn't do.
Absolutely.
It's almost like a mentor situation. And
it is. It's definitely a mentorship situation. I'm really fortunate that I have him, you know, in my life to help me not only with, you know, my project, but he helps me with the business side and the artistry side. And it's really nice to have that kind of support, because you know, sometimes when you feel like you're alone all the time, you know, but I have him, so he definitely mentors me and helps me along my path, so I'm really fortunate for
that's
that.
Cool. That's really cool. Now let's go ahead and roll into the whole situation. How did you guys meet up?
I met Dalvin about 9 years ago. I was doing another TV show called Live in Hollywood, and I was I was performing on the show, and he came with some friends to watch me perform. And he told me, at that time I was only, I think, 13 or 14 years old, and he goes, you know, whenever you're ready to do some music, just let me know, you know, I'll work with you whenever.
Excellent.
And I kind of waited a few years, because when people say that, I didn't really think that he was serious about it. I'm like, he's just being nice, whatever, you know, he's a big shot. He's got many other things to do.
Right, right.
But years later, I actually reached out to him, and he was like, oh my gosh, I remember you. I would love to. I was like, I can't believe you remembered me. Oh my goodness.
Wow.
So, yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. So he extended the hand out, and I took him up on the offer years later.
Cool. So when professional relationship began, it was just easy right off the bat. There was no like
it was
time
easy
to kind of get to know each other. Was like, boom, we're musically connected.
Yes, it was so easy. And shockingly, it was, because you know, you meet a lot of people along your journey who mm-hmm. you do a project with, and you know instantly, okay, this is gonna be the end of that. Yeah. I will never go back to them. I don't like the way they work. I don't like the way they question me, you know. But with him, I didn't even have to explain anything. He just knew what I want and just did it.
That's cool.
And the first project that I worked with him on was a song called Carolina, Throw Your Hands Up. I was actually asked by some people from North Carolina to write like an anthem, a rally song for the Bobcats and the Panthers.
Right, right.
And he's from North Carolina, so I'm like, that'd be perfect to work with him. You know, he could write the lyrics. He knows everything to say. And he wrote that song in like, it felt like 5 minutes. Like, he goes so fast. Mm-hmm. And I've never worked with anybody that was able to write something that hot, that fast.
Well, I think we have that right here. Yes, we do.
Yes, we do.
Ladies
That's
and gentlemen,
it.
This is the track by Autumn. Carolina, you want to go ahead and sing along with it?
Make it stand up, Carolina. Throw your hands up. Got that beat so hot. Make it stand up.
From the NC down to SC. We got the Bobcats, the Panthers, and UNC. The home of Jordan from number one champions.
Yeah, he
Carolina
wrote this song so fast.
Place where you get it from.
I think that's the thing that impressed me the most, was like the speed.
Right, right.
I've never seen anybody do that before.
That song rocks.
Yes.
And the thing is, he didn't even write it down.
Really?
No. He just goes, okay, you're going to go like this. From the NC. And I'm like, wait, I got to write that. I don't remember. I'm like, how do you do that?
Well, see, I mean, he's a platinum artist.
That's right.
He knows what
I
the
really
hell
am
he's
working
doing
with the best.
Yeah, that's cool. That's cool. Has Cam Newton heard that yet?
I have no idea, but I pay her to say these nice things.
No, not at all.
So that's one particular track you got working with Mr. Dalvin anymore. What's going on with the album?
Yes, I don't have a release date for my album, but my single called 911, we're actually going to be releasing at the end of May.
Mm-hmm.
And Dalvin was a part of every song that I've done on my album. We haven't decided if we're going to release it in an EP or an entire album.
Oh, you got to do a full album, girl.
That's what I would love to do, but we're going to put the single out and kind of see what happens before we make that final decision.
And the first one's supposed to be 911, right?
911 is the single. We just shot the video last month.
I think I have a little snippet of that.
Let's play it.
Let's go ahead and play that to everyone.
I'm so excited about this one.
911, Miss Opsane, Miss Amelia. Calico, click what's happening. Breeza Leo, Miss Opsane.
911 emergency, body got control of me. Systematic ecstasy, complex virtuality. Come on and give me more. I like it.
Sing it, girl.
That's what I'm waiting for. Can't find it. And it's crazy the way you're making me feel. And I'm ready, so baby, what's the deal? Tell me, can you handle it? Gotta be a man about this. Show me you got muscle, put in work now. I'm reaching for it, and I submit to it. Can be the boss of it, and I'll be good to it. Make all the rules and that, what do you need? Play my position, baby, tell me where you want me.
We gotta give a big round of applause for that one.
Thank you. Thank you. You can expect it out end of May.
That's the joint right there.
I like that.
That's
Thank
the
you.
Slap.
You gotta start playing that at Redux.
Oh, you better give me like the pre-master.
Of course.
Like,
you know I
ASAP.
Am, Sam.
That is nice. That is nice.
Thank you.
Great work on that. So there's no timetable yet for the release. It's just all being put together right now.
It's all being put together. Yeah,
okay.
But just expect something end of May. All with right. The video, too. The video's so hot. So hot. I can't wait for everyone to see that.
Well, be sure to let us know about that so we could go ahead and blast it out on TV EPN and on the Slam Show.
That's I will. Sure. Thank you.
Cool. Let's roll over to our platinum guest artist here. Let's give him a big round of applause, Mr. Dalvin from Jodeci.
Thank you.
You are just a natural on the mic, bro.
I appreciate
you should just come
it.
Over here as a guest host.
And we're the The colorful headphones.
Yeah.
I wear the rainbow.
The 49er ones.
Yeah.
See, JP, he'll rock anything, man. There must be some, like, behind the scenes.
You gotta get on some platinum headphones that you need. Yeah.
Some bling.
I'll be dazzling before I come.
There you go.
Well, welcome, Mr. Dalvin.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
For coming down. Now, let's go ahead and a lot of our viewers out there want to know about the whole Jodeci situation and all that. Obviously, if you don't know, he's the younger brother of Devontae Swing.
Yes.
Which he is the main producer of the group. And obviously, Casey and JoJo, we all know that.
Yeah.
The whole period of being in Jodeci, because you were actually, you know, you're technically the fourth guy in that whole totem pole in terms of, like, what people know and so forth. How did you handle all that?
Well, you know, when Jodeci actually came out, I was 16. But let me go back and correct. I wasn't the fourth person to total pole. I was just equal as everybody else.
Okay.
You know,
thank you for clarifying that.
That's okay. But it was just that, you know, I just took the lower road to just make everything behind the scenes happen, mm-hmm. more than just trying to be out in the forefront, because I was the glue that kept the whole group together.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So I knew my mission was not just only producing and writing, because I produced some of my biggest hits and wrote some of the biggest hits we had, which people didn't know, because, you know, Devontae took a lot of credit. But my main thing was, and my main focus was, just to be the glue to the group. You know, even when things went haywire and didn't make sense, I made them make sense. You feel what I'm saying?
Right.
So, I was 16 years old, you know, when we first came out. And, you know, I just...
Really?
Yeah, I'm 16.
Wow.
Yeah, I was 16 when Forever My Lady came out. I was 16. So, I mean, you know, but I knew and I figured that it was more important for me to not just try to shine in the beginning, because I knew I could always shine.
Mm-hmm.
But my main thing was to keep the group rolling and keep us together when everything got hectic. So that was my main focus, instead of trying to shine the time, because I knew it was always going to be my time to shine one day. So that really didn't make sense to me.
Okay, so let me calculate this in my head. Basically, you're like the father figure for the group, because the group is kind of like a whole bunch of kids that are just out of control at that period, right?
Well, I mean, we was young. We was all young. And it was, you know, it was new to us. And we had no structure, nobody to teach us and show us how this thing operated. So we had to try to figure it out ourselves. But I kind of like start understanding how it was going,
mm-hmm.
besides, you know, Casey, JoJo, and Devontae. So I kind of just figured out the business side of it.
Right.
You know, because we really didn't know the business. We just knew how to perform and sing and record.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we didn't know the business. So I had to figure that out. And that's what I figured out.
Wow. So because you, before mentioned, you didn't do any drugs or do any.
Oh, no,
any
never, of that. Never. Never.
So basically, you were the stable mind of the group.
Well, I mean, I was a little erratic sometimes, you know.
But you were mature beyond your years. That's what I'm getting at.
But I figured out I had to be, though, you know what I'm saying? Because we was all over the place. And it's like, man, come on, let's get this together.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, everything down to everything we've ever worn as far as clothes, you know, I put everything together, you know, because, you know, when we had our first budget to go do our first photo shoot, they wanted us to wear some glittered suits.
Like ready for the world, huh?
Yeah, like ready for the world. And you know what I did? I went to the Army Navy store and I spent all our money on them boots and black jeans, black jackets, black t-shirts, black scullies. I spent all the money to make sure we'd have no more money to go spend on those suits. And I brought it back and it was like, man, what the hell is this? I said, this was going to make us Jodeci. I told them, this is going to make us Jodeci. Everybody cussed me out. And when we did that photo shoot, everything was about Jodeci boots, Jodeci, the Bad Boys of R&B. That's what solidified us as far as our imaging. And everything from then on, I made sure that we was dressed the proper way.
Okay.
From then on, ever since our whole career as far as Jodeci. So, I mean, you know, that's just what
that
was.
Yeah, I do remember those boots. I said, I want one of those.
Yeah, the Jodeci boots.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I made sure I spent all the money so we have no more money in our budget. No more money in our budget to spend on nothing else, like as far as clothes.
Yeah.
Wow.
They let the 60-year-old spend the money, huh? That's crazy.
Yeah, but they thought I was going to get some suits made, because that's what I told them. But I went to the Army Navy store, though.
Mm-hmm.
You could have asked Dr. Dre if he could buy his old glitter suit from when we did that.
World class.
Dre, can I use your suits?
Yeah. So how old was everybody in the group? Were you guys all teenagers?
Yeah, it was all teenagers.
On that first album MCA?
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was all teenagers. I mean, I'm the youngest one in the group, so... was all teenagers.
And what's Devontae's age, right? Was he like 3 years older, 4 years older?
I don't talk about his age.
Don't put him up last.
Yeah, we all Peter Pan, man. We timeless, man. You know, everybody's timeless in my group. You know, it don't even matter. So we all timeless.
I'm gonna start using that, JP. Timeless.
Yeah, we timeless.
I'm gonna start using Peter Pan.
I like that.
We got those Peter Pan headphones on over there.
Yeah, we got.
Peter Pan, here you go.
Right on, right on. Yeah. So it's a good thing to know that even at a young age, you were very mature. In terms of how you wanted to handle the business.
Right.
Were there things that you may have done differently back then, like, that really stand out, like, gosh, we should have made this decision to work with this person, or kind of like not talk smack? Give us some little insight
on that. That's anybody in life. You always think that you should have made a different decision, but you can't live life with regrets. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of things we could have did a lot different, but when you're not knowledgeable about a lot of things, then you can't make the right decisions at that time. And we didn't have any kind of people that was knowledgeable to teach us at the time, even down to our accounts. We didn't even know. You know, you just go, and then you learn as you go. And life experiences is the best experience you can have living. And then the cool thing about it, though, you go through it and you suffer a lot of things, but the cool thing about it is you can always get back on your feet and do the same thing over again. That's the cool thing you can always do.
That's right.
You know, you just can't live regrets, because live regrets, you're going to always feel like you let yourself down. And we feel like that, you're going to lose your confidence in who you are and what you can do. So you don't live regrets. You just get back on your feet and do it all over again.
That's right. Well said. Well said. So there is a Sean Puffy Combs connection with the whole thing.
Absolutely.
And was he technically just a consultant or a manager? Or what was his role early on?
Well, you know, he was an intern at Uptown Records, which was our first record label.
Right.
He was an intern. So we came cool, and, you know, he showed us around New York, because we was from the country. You know, from North Carolina. We didn't know nothing about New York. So, I mean, and he was from D.C. So when he got there, he became an intern at Uptown Records. And, man, him became cool. He would take me to clubs and, you know, we danced. You know, we
at 16.
Yeah, at 16.
Yeah, existing.
Wow.
Yeah,
like that.
Yeah, right. I was actually before I got. I know Jonas came out when I was 16. I got to New York when I was 15. So I hang out with him when I was 15.
Wow.
He would take me to clubs, but he was young too. He was only like 18 though.
So he was.
He was only like 18.
At 21 and over clubs. Amazing.
Yeah, we've been all the clubs in New York. You know, we go all over. He had a little Volkswagen Beetle. It wasn't the Beetle. It was the little hatchback joint.
What? The Rabbit?
The Rabbit. That's what it was. He had a Rabbit.
He had a Rabbit.
Wow. He had a white Rabbit. And we would drive around, go to clubs, and, you know, do our thing. But, you know, that was the only connection. Like, and he was the one that really, like, when I went to the Army Navy store, like, really vouched me. Like, man, yeah, I think that's a good idea. Let's do it. Because, you know, he worked for Uptown. And then I remember Andre Harrell told him, if this don't work, you won't have a job tomorrow.
Oh, wow.
Like that.
That's what he told him. You know, Andre Harrell, he was the president of Uptown Records.
That's right.
So I was like, he's like, if this don't work, you won't have a job tomorrow. So we did the photo shoot, and you know, it turned out to be what it was. And, you know, we sold 35 million records.
That's right.
So did Andre, like, was his vision to make you guys like another, like a Boyz II Men, like the clean cut group?
He wanted to be like Guy. Remember Guy?
Guy, yeah.
He wanted to be like Guy.
Like the Teddy Riley and the disco shorts and everything.
And I was like, that's
chill
that,
guy.
And I was like, because you know what? To be honest, when we first got signed, I was like, man, we didn't really know what image we wanted. We had the MC Hammer pants on and everything.
Wow.
And I was like, man, this ain't us, bro. We got to do something different. I said, this ain't us, man. And so when they thought I was going to get some suits made, that's what I said. I went to the Army Navy store. And that's just what it was.
Wow.
That's
I got my Jodeci boots on right now.
Oh, you did?
Right?
Well, not quite, but yeah, they're cool. They're cool. It's close to him.
Those are close to him, though.
Well, getting back to those days when you're able to experience all this, obviously they're good times.
Oh, yeah.
And
plenty.
Numerous. You know, we don't want to, talk about the groupie thing or anything like that, because it's pretty clear cut.
Right.
Let's talk about, like I before mentioned, there's certain relationships that you should have, like, addressed in a better way in terms of being able to work with other artists or other producers. What really stands out is something that maybe Jodeci should have considered during that time but didn't.
Well, you look at it like this. I mean, Jodeci ought to have been a self-contained group, though. Like, we're not a manufactured group, like you say, a Boyz II Men, which I respect them. we don't have to go out and get the hottest producers. We write and produce everything we do.
In-house.
That's all. We've never had to go get outside producers, even though we've discovered Timbaland, Missy, Ginuwine, you know, Static, mm-hmm. you know, all these groups, Player, everybody. You know, we've never had to go outside and get producers. So, I mean, but stepping outside of Jodeci, I've worked with Wu-Tang Clan. I work with, you know, Raekwon, Ghostface, Mariah Carey, you know, Mary J. Blige. I mean, you know, I've produced for other people, but we never had to do that, though, as far as our group. You know, most groups do because they manufacture groups, though. You know, people put them together, and they don't produce. They just sing. And, you know, you have to go get producers. We don't have to do that, though.
Right.
Like, I can go to the studio any day and make a track. And, you know, my brother write, I write, you know, Casey write, JoJo write. And so it's like we never had to do that, though. And people we wanted to work with, we always work with, though. You know what I'm saying? Like, we did stuff with Stevie Wonder. I mean, like people that we wanted to work with. We never really had to just step outside our group to feel like we had to have a hit. Like, you know, mm-hmm. Redman was on our second album.
Right.
You know, but we really want to do features. We always like our songs to be Jodeci.
Okay, so if Justin Bieber said, I want to go and work with you guys, would you say yes?
Of course.
Okay.
I mean, of course. Like, I mean, anybody comes to want to work with us, and we'll do it, you know, yeah. whether it's solo or with the group, you know what I'm saying? Of course.
Okay.
You know, yeah. I mean, I like Justin Bieber. Like, I like artists. I don't hate no artists. I mean, I appreciate everybody's art, you know, artistry, you know what I'm saying? I respect every artist that's even trying or doing it.
Yeah.
You know, so I would never say no to any artist unless I just didn't like them.
Right, right.
And there's a couple of artists I might just be like, man, hold on, man. Let me think about it for a second.
And do you want to name those?
Nah.
Nah. Now, but currently, there's a trend right now for a lot of these 90s boy bands coming back.
Right.
You before mentioned Boys to Men.
Right.
I'm seeing, like, Color Me Bad.
Right.
All for One.
New Edition, yeah.
New Edition,
yeah.
Doing these little casino tours. Now,
yeah.
You also have, like, other boy bands that are doing stadiums, like Backstreet Boys.
Right.
And New Kids on the Block. Where does...
Like, back then, I was with a different management team. And, you know, my brother got his own management company. Case and JoJo got there. So, you know, everybody just had to come together and just, okay, let's do it then. And just, you just set a date, and then we just commit to the date.
Mm-hmm.
You know, then we don't let the management get in between us, though.
Right.
You know, we family. We all grew up together. So we don't let the management destroy what we got. You know, they figure that out on their own.
Yeah.
When we get together, even when in rehearsal and everything, it's just like we never left each other. You know, y'all figure all this stuff out. I don't even want to talk about it. You know, I don't want to talk about all that. Y'all figure that out.
Gotcha.
You know, so.
Gotcha.
I mean, it gets difficult because you got different personalities and everybody's been successful on their own. So it gets a little difficult. That's like looking at the Eagles. You know, they've been a group for what, the last 50 years. They don't even speak until they go on stage.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But they don't even speak. They don't even speak to each other. It's like, okay, well, that's me. We're also going to make $200 million this year.
Yeah. It's just a job.
Yeah, they don't even speak. But we speak, like, we play, we do everything together, you know what I'm saying? So it's not like that.
Gotcha. And I'd like to apologize for everyone out there. There was a little technical difficulty because we have an enormous amount of people viewing the Ustream, and it kind of slows down the bandwidth, but we're back on, and we're ready to go and continue. All right. Now, let's go ahead and go with the next question. After this question, guys,
okay.
I want my co-host to go ahead and give your direct insight on what you want to ask Mr. Dalvin.
Okay.
The boy band culture right now, what's your perspective on it? Do you think it's at a good place right now, or do you think it's kind of regressed from when it was back then when it was peaking for you?
Well, I mean, you talking about as far as pop or R&B?
Let's go with both.
Well, R&B, I don't really know any bands that's out right now as far as R&B. I mean, I don't even really know. Like, what's a band that's out right now, though?
Yeah, it's mostly solo artists now.
Yeah, solo. I don't even know a band that's out right now.
Yeah, you still have your ushers.
Yeah, like you know, solo artists. Yeah, I mean, solo artists all day. Like, you know, that's all day. But as far as like R&B bands, I don't know any. I just know like old school R&B bands that's just touring and making money right now. But as far as new artists, I don't even know.
Right.
You know any of them?
Yeah. Day 26 was the most relevant. That my head. I don't even think.
Day 26.
They're not even together anymore, though.
Yeah. But that's the most.
Yeah, that's the most. That's the most current one, though.
They're still laying out some new tracks, but they did. But they're not together.
They're not together. Yeah. That was like 3-4 years ago.
Yeah, that was a while ago.
Yeah, that speaks volumes as far as the culture.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, you know, you got because I'm gonna tell you like this. Music is a revolving door. It's going back to what real music is. You feel what I'm saying? And it's like I said, like, only bands that's not manufactured is gonna be around forever. You feel what I'm saying? And that's just what it is. I mean, music is, it just keep going around. It keep going around in circles.
Mm-hmm.
And so real music is coming back. It's making its way back slow. You know, R&B is coming back. It's coming back slowly, but it's coming back. So you're gonna have a couple of good bands that come and evolve. At some point, you know what I'm saying? But right now, out there, there ain't really none that's representing what real music is right now.
Okay.
But you got some good pop bands that's out there that's making some noise right now.
Yeah.
You know, I'm really not a big fan of them, but I mean, they do what they do.
Like The Wanted.
Yeah.
One Direction.
One Direction.
And what's the dude with the hair, all the hair?
The dude with all the hair?
What's the name? The One Direction or something?
Yeah.
Four Kids.
Yeah, they're doing... I've never even heard one of their songs, though.
Yeah.
And they're just blowing up all over the place. I've never heard a song.
I've seen, like, commercials for 2013 tours. I'm like, already?
Yeah. That's what I'm saying, yeah.
2012.
I've been trying to hear their music, but I can never get it. I can never catch it, though.
I'll give you MP3. No problem.
Okay,
I'll hook you up with that.
Yeah, I've never heard it.
Yeah, I'm with him. I'm like, who are you guys talking about?
That's what I'm saying. I see them all over the place, though. I've never heard none of their songs, though.
Yeah, okay.
And they got, like hundreds of thousands of screaming fans all over the place. I'm like, well, can I hear a song? Every time you see them, they're just making appearances.
That's right.
Can y'all perform and do something?
That's what it's boiling down to. Just all show.
Yeah, it's all show. Like, what do y'all do?
Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah, it is amazing, though.
Lady Sage, you have a question for Miss Dalvin?
I have a question first for Autumn and then for Dalvin.
Okay.
Autumn, I remember seeing a play a few years back. You did Cinderella.
Yes, I did.
And are you more focusing on being a solo artist, or do you want to transition into possibly Broadway?
I want to do both, all of it. Right now, you know, my solo project is coming out, so that is what my focus is. But I definitely want to do Broadway as well. My dream in life is to win a Grammy, a Tony, and an Oscar.
Oh, wow.
So I hope that one day I'll be able to achieve all that.
Because I mean, I'm not really into plays, but when I saw Cinderella, I was like, wow. Uh-huh. That was a really good.
Beautiful one. Thank you.
Remember that slam?
Yes, I do.
It was in the city. It was LaTanya who put it together. Who directed it. Yes.
Extraordinary performance.
Yes.
Thank you.
Cool. DJ Stallion, you have a question?
I have a question for
Dalvin. Sorry.
How do you feel about autotune?
I don't have no problem with, you know, people using it. I don't need it when I go in the vocal booth. I don't need it. So, well, I mean, you know, everybody got their thing. I'm not against it, you know, but I don't need it. You know,
I mean, that's
saying?
That autotune goes way back before TV.
You got Roger and Zapp.
Yeah, 78 and 79.
Yeah, it goes way back. But
that's a real deal.
Do you implement it in your work?
Well, I haven't on this project. On my project, I haven't. Okay. I haven't. You know, and as far as Jodice, we've never used autotune. It's like, you know, when it's like when we go in the studio, sometimes you might be a little off, so you just go back and correct it. That's what we did. We didn't have to go and autotune nothing. We just fix it. Like, let me do that again. You know, and that's just what, you know, that's what I say. That's what real music is. We didn't have to depend on autotune. But, I mean, you know, it's cool. It sound is good. I've never been opposed to it. Like, as far as me, I don't need it. You know, Autumn don't need it. So, I mean, it's just, you know, sometimes you just got to fix the mistakes and, you know, slightly put, like, reverb or something on your voice and, you know, different things. But
not autotune.
Yeah, not autotune. Not for me. I mean, I'm not opposed to it, though. I mean, it's good for, you know, T-Pain made it famous.
I was just going to say that. It's like, there was actually a whole song with T-Pain. It's all autotune.
That's all he does, though.
It kind of drove me nuts.
Yeah. I mean, that's all he does. But, I mean, I like T-Pain, though.
Yeah.
You know, I like T-Pain.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I like T-Pain, but that, I mean, that's his thing, though. He brought it back.
Yeah, I mean, because I remember watching Rodgers at in concert, and the way they did it was hooked to their little keyboard, and the guy had a tube going down the throat.
Yeah,
that was a vocoder.
That's a vocoder.
But it was kind of
similar.
That's a vocoder, though. That's a little different from autotune.
I think, like, what a lot of people, what the initial use case was for Ontario's autotune was just... if a producer's in the studio and the artist is in it and they find a note that's pitchy, they go in there and they fix one note.
Yeah,
and that was the original use for that.
Yeah, exactly.
But then next, you know, people are like, let's just turn it all the way up. You know?
Yeah, everything. Hey,
you're notorious. You're exactly right. You're exactly right, though. That's what it was at first.
Yeah.
That's what it was.
Interesting.
Wow. Great. Thank you. Thank you for that insight.
Oh, appreciate it.
Stallion?
Thank you.
All right, Autumn, if you could pick up the phone right now and call one artist to work with, who would it be?
Definitely Beyonce.
I knew he was going to say that.
Definitely her. She is like the queen of all the pop R&B artists, you know, in my opinion. I think she's wonderful.
Okay. And Dalvin, out of all the songs you did, like, you know, Freaking You and Cry For You and Stay and Lately, which song dropped the most panties?
they all pretty much did.
I know.
What my favorite song was, my whole favorite Jodeci song was Cry For You, though.
Okay.
My brother wrote that.
Okay.
So that was my favorite Jodeci song of all time. Even the ones I wrote, that was my favorite Jodeci song of all time. All right. For you.
Right on. JP?
I had a question for Dalvin. You know, back in the day, you always used to see rappers had their battles and they had their beefs and all that stuff. Was it the same thing with R&B groups back in the day? I mean, not that you guys hated each other, but was there like a healthy competition amongst you guys? Or?
Well, I'm going to tell you like this. Yeah. We was on tour with MC Hammer, Boyz II Men, and you know, that was like me, us and Boyz II Men was like the two biggest R&B groups, and we used to go at it all the time.
Wow. Yeah.
But me and Wanye, who's actually, you know, singing Boyz II Men, we were really good friends. It was more like it wasn't like really beef, but it was like a competition thing.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I remember one time we did the Soul Train Awards. It was us, Color Me Bad, and Boyz II Men. I don't know if y'all remember seeing that.
I do.
And they put us in this doghouse. It was a big doghouse. And Boyz II Men went on, they did their little thing, and Color Me Bad came on, and then we came out last, and we killed the whole crowd.
Yeah.
And I mean, we told Boyz II Men backstage, y'all can't fuck with us. That was the bottom line.
Nice.
But I mean, we were all friends, though. It was like a friendly competition.
Yeah, right, exactly.
It was, you know, I respect them for what they do. I mean, I love their music, though, too.
Yeah.
So it was never like no beef thing. You know, when we was on tour, we used to go to the parks, like when we had days off and go play basketball and stuff. So it wasn't really like we had beef, but it used to be a competition on stage every night. You know what I'm saying?
Right. Do you think, like one of the groups that I produce is an R&B four part harmony group as well.
Okay.
Do you foresee that type of R&B, those type of groups making a comeback?
I mean, you look at it like this, man. I mean, as long as you make quality music, you can bring anything back.
Yeah.
You can bring, I mean, it's the quality of the music that you do. I mean, it ain't like guy groups are just extinct, like we just dinosaurs and went away.
Right.
It's just like your music is the quality of what you do. It shows who you are, and people can't deny that. You feel what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So that's just the bottom line. I don't think that guy groups, R&B groups are over. Mm-hmm. You know, it can't happen again. It's just the quality of music you do. People just started making bad music. People started making bad music. It was like
meaning a lot of tune, right?
A lot of tunes and just making trendy songs. You make some good music, and that's just it. Yeah. That's just it. You know what I'm saying?
Right on.
Well, so can I have one more question?
Yes, sir.
Autumn, did you ever think about like a singing in a group, or did you always want to be a solo artist?
You know, I've always wanted to be a solo artist. There was one point about 3 or 4 years ago, I was actually asked to be in a girl group of four girls, and it never ended up working out. And I'm really happy because that was just a confirmation to me that I'm meant to have a solo career.
So you did try it out, and you realized that the same for me.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Good for you. Too much drama.
Yeah, girl groups is always drama, man. Yeah. I've worked with plenty of them. I've worked with men. It's always drama. Huh?
The caddy.
You don't even know.
Everyone wants to be the limelight.
Right.
Well, JP could attest to that because he has worked with girl groups
and
how those struggles are versus male group. Share those experiences.
I think I've seen both. I've seen female groups that are really close. So close that they're not catty towards each other, but they are very protective about one another, like a sisterhood. Mm-hmm. And then I've also seen groups that have just kind of self-destructed. You know, it's one or the other.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
I think it depends on the personalities.
Yeah, exactly.
That are in there, so.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
So When it comes down to it, Mr. Dalvin, where does your project stand? What's your focus on the future? Talk about what's up and coming.
Well, you know, I just completed a solo project. I'm just going to make the business of just like mastering it and mixing it and getting it to the sound where I want it really sound like, you know, but it's already recorded and everything. Mm-hmm. And the project is called Egomaniac. So, you know what I'm saying? I'm just getting it to where I want it, and then I'm going to release it.
And you produced, wrote this, everything else?
Actually, I work with my nephew, who's Devontae's son. Okay. We worked together on the whole project, and, you know, we just put our heads together, and the sound is so incredible. It's so incredible. Like, you know, I just went on some aggressive R&B. It's not even typical R&B. It's just, like, really aggressive.
Yeah, I was reading something about that on your EPK.
Yeah.
That aggressive R&B. Explain what that is.
Well, not aggressive is like I'm just calling everybody bitches and hoes and nothing like that. Aggressive meaning like the sound is just so unique.
Right.
You know, I kind of took the old Jodeci sound and put it with like new sounds. Because like I'm really into production as far as like sounds, drum sounds, everything. And my nephew, he's an incredible producer.
Mm-hmm.
So he knew where I was trying to go. And I just create this sound like it's almost like futuristic.
Right, right.
So that's why I call it aggressive, because it's so different.
Gotcha.
And I'm pushing the envelope to make things. I didn't want to go for no neo soul, no nothing.
Yeah.
Like that. I just wanted something totally different. So that's what I did, and I achieved what I was trying to do. You know. So that's why I call it aggressive, because when we sat in the studio, me and him were just sitting there writing and producing and everything. I was like, man, no, change that drum sound. You know, change this keyboard sound.
Yeah, yeah.
Put this sound right here. You know what I'm saying? And he. Everything I asked him to do, he figured out. He's going to be like one of the next producers.
Ooh.
Yeah, he's going to be one of the next producers. He's great at what he does.
Devontae's son, huh?
Yeah, Devontae's son.
You want to give him a shout out?
Justin, what's up? I'm kind of mad at Justin right now because he's supposed to bring me to the airport this morning. And he didn't.
We're all fam.
Yeah, but he'll be okay.
It's just the same guy that's good in Madden.
Yeah, that's how I want you to play. That's my nephew.
Uh-oh.
Man, yeah. Mike's got a lot of pressure right now.
I know, man.
Yeah, that's him. That's
a deuce, and he can whoop your butt.
Slam and mix, right?
Slow down on the whoop your butt.
Yeah.
So, just let me throw some questions randomly at you.
Okay.
Walking down the mall, does anyone recognize you?
Well, you know, it's been a while. Like, I really don't go to the mall that much no more, but, like, every now and then people be like, I know you from somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
I know you from somewhere because I'm always got my shades on, my hat on, and you know, I mean, but randomly people know, but when I go somewhere and somebody know I'm there, they know who I am when I'm there.
Right, right.
You know what I'm saying? But randomly in the mall, like, people be like, I know you from somewhere. Do I know you? And I be like, nah.
You don't try to work it together and just say...
Nah. Even when girls try to talk to me, I never use that Jodeci stuff, man. I don't be like nothing, man, you know.
You don't come out in the Jodeci boots no more?
Nah, I don't do that.
No shirt on?
Nah.
I've been with him in the mall a few times, and I'll have to say that people definitely know who he is.
Really?
Sure. I can notice it, and I think a lot of people are just intimidated. They don't want to come up and say anything, but they recognize him.
Yeah,
they
but you know what it is? People, they recognize me, who I am, but they really don't know who I am. They know I'm somebody, but they don't know who I am.
Yeah. But so you never clarify yourself and say,
I never. Even when they ask, I'm like, no.
Yeah.
No, I'm like, no.
You don't go up into the like, front of the line over at like the movie theater and like, I'm from Jodeci. Give me some perks. What's up?
Nah, I never do that. I mean, when I have to establish myself and get somewhere and get perks, they already know he's somebody, but they don't know. And I have went to the front of the line, but I've never said I'm from Jodeci. I've never said that, though.
Do you know who the F I am?
Sam's just wanting to do that so he get the new Madden 13.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Right on.
I've done that. To get Grand Theft Auto when it first came out.
There you go.
No, I'm just joking.
I was going to really, like, take that
start
seriously.
Singing
I'm just joking.
Well, excellent interview.
Thank
Mr.
you, sir.
Dalvin,
I appreciate it. I enjoy
Autumn,
it.
This is Thank perfect. You. We're going to go ahead and take a quick music break, and after that, we're going to go ahead and close out the show with our shouts and plugs and how to reach out to your fan pages and keep in touch with you as your projects develop.
Okay.
And, yeah, that's the way we roll here on the Slam Show. This is actually the freaking you, Mr. Dalvin.
Yeah.
Ooh. A classic here on the Slam Show.
That was my choice.
You guys, hang tight. We'll be right back. Mr. Dalvin, what came in your mind putting together this remix? What was it? Was it for basically panty dropping?
Well, not actually. Actually, what happened was when we released the last album, you know, we released Freaking You, and it just started off kind of slow, and I was like, let me, you know, the radio play wasn't that good on it at first, so I told my brother, because my brother actually wrote the original version, and I was like, man, let me go back and just revamp this right quick.
Right, right.
So we was all in Rochester, New York, and I flew back to New York City, and I was like, I actually called Method Man because I wanted him on it. Mm-hmm. You know, and Raekwon and Ghostface was new at the time, and so I called RZA, you know, who's the leader of Wu-Tang Clan, and I said, man, where's Method Man at? He was in Japan. He said, but I got two new dudes that's coming out the camp. You should use them. And Raekwon and Ghostface came to the studio.
Right.
And I didn't even know what I was gonna do, so I pulled my drum machine out, and I just made the beat right there while they were standing right there.
The MPC.
I had the MPC and the SP-1200.
Okay.
So I had the guitar from the SP-1200. The bam, bam, you know.
Sexy.
Bam, 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 bam. That's from the SP-1200, and the beat was from the MPC. Though,
nice.
So,
nice.
So, you know, they laced it in, you know. And then I went on further to do some other stuff with them, but that's where it came from.
Excellent remix, brother.
Thank you. I appreciate it,
man. Much props on that.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Before we go into our shouts and plugs, I want to give a few shouts to everyone in the chat room. We have Martina Ferguson. We have Herb Whitehead, a.k.a. Oaktown. Dimu Leone. Gosh, Shamika Gainey. A whole bunch of people. The Basement from Rochester. All these are in the chat room. You guys, thank you very much for all your support, hanging out with our special guests in the studio.
Yep, yep.
Thank you. Appreciate all the love. Appreciate it.
Lady Sage, go ahead and go with your shouts first.
My goodness, this is a phenomenal show. I am just surrounded by talent from Autumn to you, Mr. Jodeci. So I'm just going to call you because you are the guy that held the group together.
Yeah, right. I'm 1/4 of them now.
And of course, JP, thank you for being
You're
a
welcome.
Guest co-host.
You're
our
welcome.
Entire crew, Slam and Sam, DJ Stallion. And to all our sponsors, we appreciate you guys all equally, especially Kinders, who catered our meal today.
Mm-hmm.
Bay Manda, Perfect 10, Drinkware, Vuku Vodka. Again, we appreciate you guys. And also to all our fans out there, thank you for all the likes. We are over 2,000 now, and it's just going to keep going up.
Mm.
And yeah, thank you for the support and everyone in the chat room.
Yes, right, thank you. Thank you as well.
Well said. DJ Stallion, take it away.
All right. First, Slam and Sam, thank you for having the show. We're almost in a year in, going live on the camera-wise, so, you know, you got to keep it going.
Wow.
Ladies Sage, our special guest host, Jay, and our special guest, Autumn, thanks for coming out, and Mr. Dalvin.
Thank you, sir.
We go way back when I used to bump your tapes.
Tapes.
I got a lot of ladies. All right, never mind. and our sponsors, BTME, Mellows, Kinders, thanks for the food, guys. Fig Tree, happy birthday, Heather.
Happy birthday.
Vuku Vodka, Natural Life Foods, Liquid Nitro, Perfect Tan, Niner Empire, Drinkware, and Online Listening, my homie Savage, Stacy, and my parents.
Right on, right.
Oh,
well said.
Slam, before you continue, I forgot. Shout out to Carter Management. They're right here
in
the
room. Carter
Management.
Woo-hoo!
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right on. JP Nebras, give a little shout out.
You know, thanks for having me, guys. It's good to meet Carter Management, Mr. Dallas.
Yeah, I have fun with you,
man. Yeah, you too, man.
It's good,
you
man.
Too. Autumn, best of luck to you.
We'll switch the phones next time.
Yeah, you get the rainbow.
Okay,
I want the cool black ones. Yeah, there it is. There it is. Sam, Sage, Stallion, thank you very much. Shout out to my partners, Glenn Gutierrez and Matt Villacarte, and to all you independent artists out there looking for a digital distribution, come see us at www.planethype.com.
Excellent.
Yep.
Well said. Autumn, go ahead and take it away. The floor is yours for your shout outs.
Shout out to Carter Management, and shout out to everyone listening. Thanks for tuning in.
Okay. And is there any websites or anything that we could...
Yeah, you can always reach me on Facebook. You just want to search Autumn Carter fan page.
Mm-hmm.
You can also follow me on my website at followautumn.com. And
cool.
CarterManagement.net always has information about me as well.
Excellent. Mr. Dalvin,
it's your turn. You can reach me at Dalvin D. Great on Facebook, Mr. Dalvin on Twitter, and you know Carter Management always post stuff on my page, so you can follow me from there too.
Cool. So as of right now, there's no Jodeci appearance set up at the moment?
Well, we're actually lining up a tour right now.
Okay.
Yeah, and it should be like maybe like late June.
All right.
So, yeah, we're going to do like maybe 15 dates or 10 to 15 dates.
Oh, we got
so
backstage passes. In
of course. absolutely.
Any chance? Yeah, absolutely. You guys coming to the Bay?
Yeah, of course. Of course. Nice. Of course. Yeah, y'all know y'all straight, man. Come on.
There you go. There you go.
Y'all more than straight. Come on.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank
all
you.
Right.
It's been a pleasure.
Yes. You guys are the bomb. Thank you for taking the time to make it out here.
Thank you,
that's,
sir.
That's for sure. I want to go ahead and close out the shouts and plugs. I want to thank my entire crew, Lady Sage, DJ Stallion, my guest host, JP Nevres.
Hey.
Thank you for making the drive out here.
Hey.
I want to see you come back more again, man, so we can talk.
We'll come back.
And
let's do it. Let's come back. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And get me the black headphones. I don't want these rainbow headphones.
I'm going to get you pink camouflage.
Just for that. TT then, just to throw you off.
You know what? I'll just spray.
At least they say at least they say San Francisco, though.
Yeah, yeah, these ones are cool.
Yeah, the 49ers,
these ones. Yeah, I don't know. Is this really Hawaii?
They're more like Ziggy Marley or something.
Yeah, yeah, okay, I'll take that.
Yeah, there's no rainbow on there.
I'll take Ziggy.
Yeah. Yeah, Ziggy Marley, man.
Rastafarian.
Yeah, Rastafarian.
Or Fisher Price, like you said, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
You're too much, JP.
Those are Sam's first headphones. Come on.
I want to go ahead and thank all of our sponsors and affiliates. Without you guys, we don't keep this show going. So thank you for your entire support. Also, all the viewers out there, including the ones that are in the chat room, interacting, giving all the plugs. Thank you very much. You guys keep tuning in. We'll keep doing the show. Keep bringing you the best guests. And
keep jobbing those panties.
Take them off.
Something like that. Okay. This is a part of the show that we go ahead and give away our TV EPN prizes off our drawing that everyone that's liked the page, you have a chance to go ahead and win.
Some panties.
Yeah.
Use panties.
Rainbow headphones.
Yeah. Out of the vending machine.
With panties.
Yeah, exactly.
So without further ado, I'll go ahead and give the bowl to Autumn and either her or Mr. Dalvin shakes it up and one pulls out.
I shake it up. I let Autumn try to shake it up.
Okay.
Okay.
And go ahead and read off the name.
Is it for this? The panties?
I'm not sure what we're going to give away, Sage. What do you think?
Surprise!
Well, we have a lot.
Depends if you're a guy, calendar.
Yeah.
If you're a chick, a calendar.
Ready?
Exactly.
Daniel Wagner?
Daniel Wagner, congratulations.
Yay.
You are the TV EPN prize winner.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
That is dope. That
some panties.
Yeah,
scratch and sniff panties.
That's right.
You have the video. There it is.
You guys are disgusting. Once again, I want to thank Carter Management, Wayne, Robin, obviously, Autumn, being able to come through. Once again, I missed you, girl.
I missed you, too. So yeah. Good to see you.
Yeah, I mean, you just grew up right before my eyes, and it's like, aww, I'm so happy for you.
Well, thank you.
And being able to associate yourself with this incredible gentleman here, Mr. Dalvin.
I appreciate that. That means a lot. That means a lot.
All right. We're going to go ahead and close out the show. And
oh, yeah.
Come and talk to me remix.
Panties out the vending machine.
Here it is.
You guys.
Vending machine song.
Take care. See you next week.